On Sunday nights, we're in a study of the kings of Israel. And of course, we've got that on a chart here. Here's all the kings that reigned in Israel. Now, there were kings, there were men in the lineage of the kings. Of course, the true kings of Israel, they had to come out of the tribe of Judah. And of course, Judah, Jacob, had 12 sons, 1, 2, 3, 4. The first four were by Leah, the wife that he worked for, and it was a disgrace for the oldest daughter to marry, the younger daughter to marry before the older daughter. That's why Laban gave Leah to Jacob, and that's why he didn't argue. He knew the custom, even though he had worked for Rachel. And when Leah was given to Jacob, it's a good thing. Of course, his name was changed to Israel. Israel. And the first four sons are very, very key to studying Israel. Reuben. And Reuben lay with Bilhah, the handmaid. And, of course, he lost his birthright to the 11th son. And, of course, the 11th son was Joseph. And Joseph received the birthright, and his second-born son, Ephraim, had a double portion, and he was the ruler, he was the owner of all Israel. Of course, the ruler came out of Leah's son, Judah, and that's where the king will come from, the king. And, of course, we've said so many times that God was the king of Israel. This is called Kingdom of God. That's what Israel was called, because it was God's kingdom. And the main reason for that, God picked Israel out. He said there in Deuteronomy 7:7, he said, I didn't choose you because you were greater. He said, I did the choosing, and I didn't do it because you were somebody. He said, you were least of all the kingdoms. You were nobodies. And that's what he says over there in 1 Corinthians 1:26-27, when he says that not many mighty, not many wise, not many noble in this world are called. And then he says he takes the base things of the world to confound the wise. He takes little bitty nobodies. What's so unbelievably amazing, here's Israel in the eastern end of the Mediterranean, this little bitty piece of land, and everyone in the world, this is smaller than the land size of New Jersey. And everyone in the world is looking at that. Isn't that amazing? I mean, here we are today, all of the world is looking at Israel. Well, so God picks out Israel, and he just chooses them out of a particular lineage, and they come out of that lineage of Seth. Of course, Seth's descendants, you look at him in Genesis, the 5th chapter, his father was Adam, and Adam's father was God, and this is the children of God. And in this lineage, he goes down to Noah, the 10th from Adam, and then Shem, the 11th from Adam, and we get the word Semitic or Semite from Shem. And about 285 years down the road, somewhere in that neighborhood, Abraham is born. He is the descendant of Shem. Now, some people like to say, well, Abraham's descendants, the verse over there in the book of Joshua, where that his descendants on the other side of the flood were idol worshipers. Well, his fathers were idol worshipers, but father doesn't mean a direct ancestor. Father just means someone in his family, and he had ancestors. But if you'll remember, when you get down to Abraham, Abraham tells Eliezer, his servant, to go to the land of his fathers and get a believing wife. So Abraham was not an idol worshiper. Some of his ancestors and fathers, brothers were, but there were also believers in the lineage of Shem. And of course, we get the word Semitic or Shemite. And of course, Abraham has a son, Isaac, and then Isaac has a son, Jacob, and he becomes the nation of Israel. Well, God, of course, causes Israel to be in bondage for 400 years, and then they come out of bondage, and they spend 40 years in the wilderness. They come into the land of Israel, or the land of Canaan that was given to Abraham, in that that God promises to Abraham in the 12th chapter of Genesis, and then Abraham walks through the land, and God says, this is the land I'm going to give you. Well, that land was set aside so that when Israel becomes a kingdom, when they become a kingdom in 1 Samuel, they were already a kingdom, but they were dwelling among all these pagan Canaanites that they didn't drive out of the land. God said, since you don't drive them out, I'm going to put you under their rule. There in that third chapter of Judges. So he puts them under the rule of their enemies, and for 280 years or 75 years, somewhere in that neighborhood, they're under judges, and then at the end of Judges, you go right into the time period of 1 Samuel. And 1 Samuel, this is where they become a nation under a king, but not until the 9th chapter. In the 8th chapter, they ask for a king. In the 9th chapter, God points out a man head and shoulders. In other words, he's a real tall guy. He picks out a man. His name is Saul, and he's from the tribe of Benjamin. And, of course, the people said, give us a king to rule over us. Give us a man, because all the people around us have got a man who's a king. We want a man. So God picks out a man of the tribe of Benjamin, and he arranges for Saul and Samuel to meet. And when that happens, God tells Samuel, he says, this is my anointed king. Well, if you'll notice, God picked out a king from the wrong lineage. When you find God repenting that he made Saul king in the 16th chapter of 1 Samuel, when you find God repenting himself, God doesn't find some Baptist church and when they sing, just as I am, he walks the aisle and says, I just like to repent, I made Saul king. Repent means to turn. He turned from making Saul king, but he had to plan the turn because he chose a king out of the wrong tribe. So when he tells Samuel, this is the king, he's already got it planned in his mind to turn. That's what we have to understand. He's got the turn. If you go to the store and you say, I think I'll go to the store, I think I'll pull out in the driveway, well, you better plan to turn up here, because if you don't, you're going to run over that house right up here at the end of Irvin. You got to say, I ain't going to plan to turn, I'm just going to drive down here. You got several turns to plan to go to the store, don't you? Well, God had to plan his turn when he picked out a king from the wrong tribe, and he picked out a man that he knew his heart, and he fixed his heart, and he knew he was humble when he started out. Before it's over with, Saul becomes a murderer and a liar, and he ends up killing 85 of the priests of God. He has Doeg, his chief herdsman, to come up and kill him. And Saul ends up being one of the most devious, under him and lying men that ever come along in the history of the world. And what's amazing, Saul and Manasseh, and a few others in the scriptures show us that believers can be as devious and underhanded as any human beings alive. Because there's no king that did the wickedness of Manasseh. Now, this is not Manasseh the firstborn son of Joseph. Manasseh was a common name like Bill or John or Joe. A lot of guys named Manasseh. Manasseh was the son of Hezekiah, and with all of his father's righteousness, watching one of the most righteous kings that ever lived, Hezekiah. And each one of these kings had a prophet they would answer to. Well, Hezekiah's prophet was Isaiah. There was never lived two more righteous men upon the face of the earth than Isaiah and Hezekiah. Well, you would think that Manasseh, watching his father and watching his mother take advice from these kings, well, then when he comes up and seeing their conversation, the godliness and God overthrowing the Assyrian, Sennacherib comes in to attack Israel, attacks southern Judah when Hezekiah is king, and he kills 185, God kills 185,000 of the Syrians that comes to attack Jerusalem, and Manasseh watches them flee, and he watches his father's words and Isaiah's words. You would think that Manasseh would never go into wickedness, but that's just a good example. And in 1 Kings there, in 2 Kings, when I first saw Manasseh going to all this wickedness in the 20th chapter, it bothered me really bad, and I thought, gosh, this guy needs to die and go to hell. Well, when you get into 2 Chronicles, he repents. And it just shows you that Saul, people say Saul didn't go to heaven. Well, he certainly did. When he comes up against, when he goes to see the witch of Endor right before his last battle, at the end of 1 Samuel, he goes to the witch of Endor, and he says, and he goes disguised, and he says, I've got to have somebody to tell me what to do tomorrow. Samuel's been dead for 2 years, and he goes to the witch of Endor, and he says, conjure me up Samuel. I got to talk to somebody. God won't talk to him. I've been trying to talk to God, and I got to go against the Philistines tomorrow. And Samuel, of course, the witch doesn't conjure Samuel up. A vision of Samuel comes up, and the witch of Endor goes, "Ah, I never learned to do that before." You know, it's funny, isn't it? And Samuel comes to Saul, and he says, "Saul, you are a tall, wonderful, generous, handsome, quiet, gentle man, but this power is going to your head, and you become a murderer, and you become all of these things, and you're anointed of the Lord." And he said, "Tomorrow you and your sons are going to battle against the Philistines." And he said, "You and your sons," Jonathan being one of them, and Jonathan was certainly a righteous man. He was the friend of David. He said, "Tomorrow you're going to die in battle, and you're going to come and be with me." Now, we know that Samuel wasn't in hell. He said, "Tomorrow you're going to be with me." And I believe people say, why would Saul do that? Why would God give us that illustration? I believe Saul is a picture of what God does to rebellious believers. But the Bible says that, and of course, the next day, Saul fell on his sword, and there was a young Edomite that said he's the one that did it, that he killed him. Whether he did or not, Saul did make an effort to kill himself. And he told, if he did what the young man said, he said, "Follow me and kill me before my enemies get me." It was still an act of suicide, and he did go to be with the Lord. That's what the Bible says. People say, well, he couldn't repent of that sin. You mean you repented of every sin that you ever committed the day you die? You mean some guy's riding down the road and he looks over and lusts at a woman and walking down the road, and he's been this real good Christian up to this point. He hits a car, boom, and he goes into eternity. He's going to hell, right? No. First of all, that goes back to the inner and the outer man. The outer man can't keep from sinning, and the inner man can't sin. That's Christ in you, and he's going to give you a new body to go with it, new soul. Now, we're talking about the kings of Israel. We've already gone through 1 Samuel. We've been on this for 2 years. Y'all know this is about 2 years we've been on this. We've gone through 1 Samuel. We've gone through Saul's kingdom from the 13th chapter, 1 Samuel up to the 15th chapter, and then God turning his back because Saul wouldn't execute his fierce wrath against Amalek there in the 15th chapter. And in the 14th chapter, Saul wants to kill Jonathan, his righteous son, because his son goes out here and he... Stupid Saul. That guy's got to be one of the biggest morons that ever lived. I mean, Jonathan goes out and him and his armor bearer attack the Philistines by themselves. And then they go out there and just the two of them, God says, "I like that. I'll send you an earthquake to help you on your way." And Saul goes, "I've got my enemies on the run." He was hiding in a hole in the ground. And Jonathan's over there battling him. And Saul says, "Since my enemies are running before me, I'll declare this a day of fast. Anyone who eats this day, I'll have his head. I'll kill him." And Jonathan, on his way back, after him and his armor bearer attacked the Philistines, God helps him with an earthquake. Jonathan reached down, and Israel was literally a land flowing with milk and honey. And they had all these honeybees in these rocks, and they came through the pass of Michmash, which was a stony pass on the way back home. And Jonathan reached down with the tip of his rod and took some honey and ate it. Somebody come running to Saul and said, "Saul, Jonathan ate some honey. I'll kill my son." What are you talking about? A self-righteous jerk. And the people loved Jonathan so much, they said, "No, you will not." He said, "Okay." He went back. It just reminds you of the biggest, just foolish people. And it's just showing you that men can't rule God's people. We went on showing there in the 16th chapter of 1 Samuel where the Lord said, Samuel, go down to the house of Bethlehem, Judah. I got me a king among his sons. And he said, Saul's day is over with. It's done. There in the 15th chapter, he goes down to Bethlehem, Judah. And Jesse makes 7 of his sons to pass before Saul, and he says, to pass before Samuel, and he says, "No, it's none of these 7. There remains the youngest, and he's the 8th, and he keeps the sheep." And they said, "Go get David." When he comes in, the Spirit of the Lord tells Samuel, that's him. And of course, David comes from the tribe of Judah. And then begins this lineage of the kings of Judah. Now, we're talking about the kings of Israel and the promise of God to them. The promise of God is as long there in Deuteronomy 28. It doesn't matter whether we're on the 70 weeks of Daniel on Sunday morning or what we're in concerning the prophecy of God. God said, if you're obedient to me In Deuteronomy 28, he said, if you're obedient to me, and the thing that makes people obedient is their leaders. People are going to follow their leaders, aren't they? They always do. They always did. If you remember, when Israel came in from 40 years in the wilderness, God said, drive all of these people out. Well, they didn't. And Joshua dies, and he's their leader. And as soon as he dies, in the second chapter of Judges, as quick as he's dead, they go straight to Ashtaroth and Baal. Just right straight to it. And Joshua, the man of God, died, and they go and serve Ashtaroth and Baal. Just clip that quick. Well, of course, they kept doing this over and over. And what we're seeing, what we're looking at when we look at the kings, when you see the, if you have a ruling king, and he'll go after, in the 28th chapter of Deuteronomy, the 15th chapter of Exodus 15, and the 26th chapter of Leviticus, these are like sister chapters. They'll tell you if you're obedient, you've got a king who'll lead you into battle against these people. And if you're obedient to my words, you'll conquer your enemies. They'll go against you one way. They'll flee seven ways. You'll take one and send 1,000 to flight. Two of you will send 10,000 to flight. And Jonathan knew that. And David knew that when he went against Goliath in the 17th chapter of 1 Samuel. He goes out against Goliath. And then David gets all of this glory, and he's already been anointed king by God. As far as the people are concerned, Saul is still king, but David is king in the eyes of God. And then in that 18th chapter, Abner, the commanding general of Saul, says, Saul, I want to introduce you to this boy that just killed this giant. He brings David in, and Saul says, well, you seem to be quite formidable. David, you're pretty good with that sling. Would you like to go to work in my army? And of course, immediately, the women begin to shout the praises of David, singing the old hymn. Saul has slain his thousands, and David his 10,000s. And Saul goes, he's trying to steal my kingdom. Immediately in the 18th chapter, he starts trying to have David killed by putting him out in the heat of the battle. Reckon that's where David learned that? Because Saul did that to David. David did that to Uriah the Hittite, didn't he? In the 11th chapter of 2 Samuel. And he kept trying to kill David. Of course, that 19th chapter on, Saul puts a price on David's head, and he says, I want him dead. Of course, by that 31st chapter of 1 Samuel, Saul dies. And then in that 2 Samuel, we see David becomes king, and all of David's heartaches. In 2 Samuel, we see the most unbelievable story. We see David crowned king in Hebron in chapter 2 of 2 Samuel. Chapter 5, he becomes king of the whole nation, and everything seems to be at peace. And then he turns and commits murder and adultery. And then in that 11th chapter, and in the 12th chapter, Nathan stands before him and says, David, the sword will never leave your house. And in the 13th chapter of 2 Samuel, we see Amnon, David's eldest son, raping his sister Tamar. And then we see Absalom in that same chapter, in the 13th chapter, 2 Samuel. We see Absalom plotting for 2 years to murder his older brother Amnon, and he does it. And then we see Absalom fleeing Israel. And then Joab tricks David. Joab is David's nephew. He's his commanding general. He's captain of the host, and he gets Absalom back into the land. And then Absalom goes and looks in the mirror one day and says, you sure are handsome and everybody likes you. Why don't you take over Israel? So he tries to do that, and David's life collapses and falls to pieces. People say, how in the world can you get to a king? Well, God just simply caused all of his children and his best friends, Ahithophel, his chief counselor, turned on him and went with Absalom to overthrow David. And finally, Ahithophel ends up committing suicide, and David writes the famous psalm, the 55th psalm, after Ahithophel. He said, we had sweet counsel together, and you turned on me. What we're learning from the kings is how we're not supposed to live, but I'm afraid we're just like them. How many of us have, we say, well, how could they fall away? Is anybody here going out and live for themselves since they become a believer? Is anybody going off in sin? Is anybody going off drinking in clubs and cussing and carrying on and acting like heathens? Anybody here done that? Huh? don't want to admit it. We wonder why David did what he did, and why Solomon. Why did Solomon keep his 700 wives and 300 concubines, and why did he let them keep all of their idol gods? I don't understand. And Rehoboam, his son, taking such bad advice to cause the split of the kingdom, when his friends say, tell the people, your little finger will be thicker than your father's loins, and he chastised you with whips, that you're going to chastise him with scorpions. Predecessor to the Roman flagellum. Tell them, you're boss. How could you take such advice when the old men said, hey, be easier on Israel than your father was? Because your father got off in his sin with his wives and allowed him to lead his heart away, and he got hard on Israel. We don't think of Solomon just turning to sin, do we? Of course, we don't think of David. I've had people come here and say, well, I've just sinned so much, you just don't, I don't know if I can fit in here. Well, could David fit in here, huh? David, how about David? He had one of the most faithful men in his army, Uriah the Hittite. He took his wife, got her pregnant, and then murdered this dear, wonderful man that loved him. Have you ever committed that kind of sin? I don't think anybody here has done that. If you did, you probably escaped from death row. Right? And Saul was a murderer. He killed Christians for a living. So when you get to saying, you don't know the sin I've done, I don't think you've done the sin of David or Saul. No one here. And was there two more righteous men than David and the Apostle Paul? No two more righteous men in the Bible. When God forgives, he forgives completely. David was a man after God's own heart. After his sin, his house was never settled. And yet he loved God more after he sinned. You know why he penned the Psalms? Because of all those events in his life. It's utterly amazing. We look at the Psalms and we think it's a book of poetry. No, it's a book concerning David's life and Moses' life as they were coming out of all of this adversity. We're over here in 1 Kings. I won't go through all the rest of this, but we've gone through the end of David's life and Solomon's life. Solomon takes the throne from David. Of course, Solomon has a brother who tries to usurp the throne. He's Solomon's older brother. What was his name? Tries to take the throne away from David. First chapter, 1 Kings. Who is the guy who tried to take, huh? No. Huh? No. Adonijah. Yeah, Adonijah. Adonijah. Adonijah, by the way, comes from Adonai and Jehovah. The Lord is God. That's what it means. Now, Adonijah tried to take the throne. Of course, we know the story. We've gone through it. How that Adonijah just assumed this position. Got him a chariot, put 50 men to run before him. When you put 50 men to run before you, beside your chariot, that was making a self-proclamation. I am king. I'm next in line. Of course, Bathsheba and Nathan the prophet went to David and said, hey, something's amiss here, and if he gets the people behind him, we're in trouble. She says, David, husband, you're going to have to do something. Your other son, you promised the throne to Solomon. And David said, I sure did. And he got Solomon into the throne room, and he anointed him and said, you're king. And then Bathsheba and Nathan went out and said, behold the king, God save King Solomon. And Adonijah went, oops, what have I done? And Solomon said, you can live if you will behave yourself. And he didn't, and he didn't. He didn't behave himself, and he didn't live. So, in fact, who was it that Solomon had to kill? Adonijah. Ah, Benaiah. Remember who Benaiah was? No. Huh? He was a commanding general. What was he to David? What was he to David?
He was his bodyguard.
He was the head of his bodyguards. He was the head of David's bodyguards, and he was the guy you don't mess with. He, in fact, 2 men at that same time, when the throne is turned over to Solomon, 2 men were killed. Who was the other one that was killed by Benaiah?
Joab.
Boy, whew, I would love to have seen a fight between Joab and Benaiah when they were in their prime. this man here, this is the most devious, underhanded guy. This is David's nephew. David had another nephew. What was his name? His brother?
Abishai.
Abishai was David's constant companion, and Abishai was always, everywhere they went, Abishai said, "Uncle David, can I kill somebody today?" He liked going out killing people. "Can I take this dead dog's head off this Shemaiah? He's cursing you and throwing stones at you." And David's going, "Oh, shut up, Abishai. My son Absalom's trying to take the kingdom, and you're worried about some guy calling me names and throwing rocks at me. Let him throw stones, God hath bidden him." Abishai, you know, I don't know what happened to Abishai. I have looked for his death everywhere, and I can't find him. But we sure do know where Joab, this man, this was one killer. This is the most devious, unhanded man. David would tell this commander, you got to remember, the commanding generals ran the show. They ran everything. Of all the people in the Old Testament, I don't know why they haven't made 100 movies about this guy right here. This is the most unbelievably thick-headed, hard-headed, lying, low-down, double demon backstabbing guy in the Old Testament, and he's David's nephew. He's, what was his mother's name?
Abigail.
Lane knows all these. These sons of Zeruiah are too hard for me. These two guys are driving me nuts. That's what David was saying. I can't control my nephews. They're out here killing people, bringing about, and you know what? What's so amazing, they didn't try to overthrow David. They evidently cared about David. They just liked power. And you didn't tell Joab. Nobody told Joab what to do. He killed several people. Who did he murder? It's been a while since we went through this. Who did Joab? Yeah, he killed the righteous man Abner. Who was Abner?
It was Saul's general.
It was Saul's general, but how was he kin to Saul? Huh? Saul's father was Kish, right? Who was Abner's father? Ner. Father Ner. His father was a Ner. They were first cousins. This was a family affair. That's what it was. It was a this. I did one tape called it "The Young and Restless in Israel," because that's what this was. This was rape, murder, suicide, overthrowing power, hunger, grasping for. It's not unlike the soaps that you watch. Yeah. Joab, he killed somebody else. Their mother was Zeruiah. He killed Abner's first cousin, who was Saul's commanding general when David was leading southern Judah. Joab was David's commander. Joab was David's nephew by Zeruiah, and so they were second cousins removed or something. Joab and Abner were distant related. So Joab, who else did he kill?
Uriah.
He killed Uriah because David hired him to, didn't he? Uriah the Hittite. David said, "Joab, take him in the heat of battle." That's probably why David could not handle doing away with Joab. Who else did he kill?
Amasa.
He killed Amasa. Who was Amasa?
Joab's own cousin.
It was Joab's first cousin. But who was Amasa's mother?
Abigail
was Amasa's mother, and that was Zeruiah's sister. That was Joab, and so this was first cousin, and of course he did away with Amasa. Why did he do away with Amasa? Why did Joab kill Amasa? Because David set up Amasa. He's trying to get rid of Joab. And he set up Amasa to be commander after Absalom's coup was put down. What does Joab do? He don't pay attention to that. You ain't going to put me down. He goes over and stabs and says, "Okay, Marmy, come on, follow me." That's how easy he did away with Amasa.
Left him laying in the ditch.
Didn't even bury him. Say, "Hey, this is the way I do it. Let's just..." You say, "We're going to replace me." "Oh, no, you're not, Uncle David. Nobody replaces me." Who else did he kill?
Absalom.
Killed Absalom. David's beloved. And what's so amazing, when he killed Absalom, David began to weep and mourn and say, "Oh, Absalom, my son, what did Joab do?" He came in and chewed him out and said, "What are you doing, David?" I mean, this guy was the most brazen, brassy man in all of 1 Kings, through 1 Samuel through 2 Chronicles.
He wasn't afraid.
He wasn't afraid of nothing. He wasn't afraid of the devil himself. This man was one character to deal with. Of course, he met his Waterloo when he met Benaiah, didn't he? So Solomon said, "Kill him," and he went out and grabbed a hold of the horns of the altar. Why did he do that?
That was refuge.
It's supposed to be sanctuary. It's supposed to be sanctuary for everyone who had committed a crime except murderers. He grabbed hold of the horns of the altar out here. He grabbed hold of those horns, and it was supposed to be refuge. And Benaiah comes back to David, and he goes back to David and says, "He won't let go of the horns of the altar. Says I have to kill him there."
Solomon,
excuse me. He goes back to Solomon, and he says, and Benaiah goes back to Solomon and says, "He won't come out away from the temple. He says he's not letting go of the horns of the altar. He says, I've got to kill him there." And what does Solomon say?
Do it.
And he goes in there, and Joab says, "You're going to have to kill me here." He says, "That's no problem at all, Buster. Here I come." And man, he got his through Benaiah. Oh, me, how do we get off here? Of course, we get into David gets old, and he sets up Solomon for the throne. Solomon builds the temple. We're up there in 1 Kings. He builds the temple of God, and then we get to the 11th chapter, and the most amazing thing happens. We see Solomon with all of his wisdom, all the kings of the earth coming to Solomon, and they're wanting Solomon to be They're consulting Solomon about all of his wisdom. Well, we see in the 11th chapter, we see Solomon turn the way of so many kings. Here in chapter 11, verse 1, "But King Solomon loved many strange women." Doesn't mean they were weird. "My wife's strange," he said. "Married many strange women together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites." And down there in verse 3, "He had 700 wives, princes, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned his heart away from God. And he allowed them to keep all of their Molech gods." Down there in verse 5, "For Solomon went after Ashtaroth." Ashtaroth is a generic term. Ashtoreth. Or O-T-H is plural, but he went after Ashtaroth. He went after the tree gods. That's a generic term for the tree goddesses of the Mediterranean region, all throughout the region. Everybody from Venus to Diana to Mileta to Aphrodite, whoever the tree god, or the grove, which was Venus, which Israel imported into Israel out of Tyre. Now, you'll notice here, Solomon is going, he's not actually setting this up. When you get to the 16th chapter, which we're going into, we see in the 16th chapter, we see Ahab come on the scene. And he sets up something in Israel. He actually brings Baal, which was Hercules, or Mithra, and his birthday was December the 25th. He brings Baal down from what we call Lebanon here. Here's Beirut, Lebanon. Right about there is the old city of Tyre. Tyre and Sidon, these were cities of this old Phoenician Empire. And this area here in Babylon, these are the two systems that kept the fire worship alive and well for a long, long time. They were two of the wealthiest nations of the world. And it was Jezebel in the 16th chapter of this book of 1 Kings where we are. She marries King Ahab, brings this, I call it Christmas system. It's the same thing as Christmas. It is the old fire worship that Constantine brought in the church in 325 A.D. and called the Christmas. He did it because he said, "I need to bring Christians and heathens together." That's what the world is saying today. We got to bring all the believers together. They all believe in God, so let's bring them all together. Well, we're not supposed to come together with pagans who believe in another God or another Jesus. We're not even supposed to gather together with people who say they believe in Jesus and that are obedient to His word. Well, Solomon allows his wives to keep all of their and all of his concubines to keep all of their gods. And God says in this chapter, I'm going to split the kingdom because you've done this. Of course, the split of the kingdom goes to Judah. Judah and northern Israel and Israel, and that's why we see on this chart, because of what happens in the 11th chapter, we see on this chart a split. We see southern Judah on the left side of the chart, northern Israel on the right side of the chart. These are illegitimate kings over here, and as we're going through 1 Kings and 2 Kings and Chronicles, we're going to see that we're going to watch these kings as they turn one right after the other against Jehovah God. They either go after the gods of Jeroboam, and you notice this is Jeroboam the first, because you got a Jeroboam the second down here. The Jeroboam that the Bible speaks great evil of is Jeroboam the first, because he brings the golden calf into Israel. In the next chapter, we see that Rehoboam takes the bad advice from his young high school friends in chapter 12. And they say, you tell them that you're going to be harder on them than your father ever thought of being, that you'll chastise them with scorpions. When Rehoboam says this, they say, Jeroboam is a great general that Solomon has ran out of Israel, and he fled to Egypt. He comes back to Israel when he hears Rehoboam and Jeroboam become friends. Now, because their names are spelled somewhat alike, it doesn't mean that they are brothers. Those are just a way of spelling. And Rehoboam is the king. Jeroboam is a commander. And because Rehoboam takes this bad advice, Jeroboam takes the 10 tribes north. But we know that there's a prophet that came to Jeroboam and told him. And he took a piece of cloth and he tore it up. And he gives him 10 pieces of the cloth. And he says, you're going to become the king of northern Israel. Who was that prophet that told Jeroboam this? Each one of these guys have got a prophet that's actually the mouth of the Lord saying, if you're obedient to me, I'll increase your kingdom. If not, I'll destroy it. You remember the prophet? Remember Jeroboam's prophet?
Shimei.
And Rehoboam had a prophet. No, Jeroboam's prophet was not Shimei. That was Rehoboam's prophet. Huh? Ahijah was Jeroboam's prophet. Jeroboam's prophet. Each one of these guys had a prophet. The prophet was God's mouth that came to him. Let me erase this. So as we're going through, you remember I said a while ago that Hezekiah was this great righteous king, and he had a prophet, and his prophet was Isaiah. They had to have a go-between them and God, and God's mouth upon the earth was the prophet. So we said that Hezekiah's prophet was Isaiah. Boy, wouldn't that be a great combination? Life could be easy if you had Hezekiah here and Isaiah. Hezekiah to be president of the United States and Isaiah to tell him what to do. That's what we need. We need a theocracy, not a democracy. Theos is the word God. We need God ruling. In fact, that's what Israel was. It was a theocracy. The tithe was the tax. It was 23 1/3%, 10% a year to the temple, 10% a year to the priesthood, 10% every 3 years to the poor. That averaged out 23 1/3% a year, and that took care of the poor. It paved the roads. It paid the taxes. It took care of all of the buildings. It was the money that took care of it. And do I believe in a tithe? Yes, I do. It's the Old Testament shadow, the New Testament very image. It's a tenth. It takes that to run a ministry, but God has to deal with people on that when He's ready. And the Capitol building was the temple. The politicians were the priests. And they had a theocracy. God was the king, and the mouth that was the go-between between the king and between God was the prophet. So Jehoshaphat, I'll get to his prophet in a minute. But Jeroboam's prophet was Ahijah. Ahijah. That was Jeroboam. And Rehoboam. Rehoboam's prophet was Shimei. Shimei. That was his prophet. And these guys would come and tell these guys, you better behave yourself. God's going to knock you in the head with a bat or something. And of course, Ahijah keeps prophesying against Jeroboam. And when Jeroboam sets up golden calf worship to keep the people coming back south. Huh? What? Oh, A-H. Okay. You got so many Shimeis in there, so many ways to spell it. A-H. A-C-H-A-C-I-M-A-H. A-I-A-H. Okay. Shimei. And where was I? Hey, I lost my place. Huh? Yeah, each one had their own prophet. They had somebody tell them what to do. And, of course, Jeroboam sets up golden calf worship. And God sends, because he sets up golden calf worship, one of the first judgments against Jeroboam. What was one of the first judgments that God brought against him? You remember? It's found in the 14th chapter of 1 Kings. First judgment against Jeroboam because of what he's done, setting up golden calf worship. God kills his son. Remember, his wife goes down there. What's his son's name? His son's name is Abijah. His son. A-B-I-J-A-H, Abijah. He kills Abijah. Remember, his wife goes down there, and Jeroboam says, our son is sick. Go down to this Ahijah, the prophet. He's the one that put me in charge of Israel. Go down there to him and see if our son will live.
Did she try to disguise herself?
Yeah, she dressed up herself, and Ahijah's an old man. He's sitting there, and God always speaks to Ahijah ahead of time, and she's coming in the door, and Ahijah's back is to the door, and he said, come in, thy wife of Jeroboam. I like that. You see such drama and such subtleness in this. You see, Ahijah's an old, come in, wife of Jeroboam. You want to know if your son's going to live. He's going to die. Go tell your husband that. And when she goes back and she walks into the door, her son dies. Jeroboam has fixed himself good, hasn't he? And of course, we're over here. Goodness, we've kind of come all the way up to date, haven't we? Well, let's get back over here. Now, the next king after Rehoboam dies. Verse 31, chapter 14, 1 Kings. Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, dies. And his son, he's kind of not a man of great consequence. His name is Abijam. He's called Abijam here in verse 31. In fact, we're going to look over here in 2 Chronicles. Now, when you're reading 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles, they are like, they're not unlike Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which are synoptic gospels. They have synonymous views. 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles are, they are books that have a lot of the same stories, but you got to read both accounts so in case you miss something that the other one will tell you. Well, here we are. Read verse 31, chapter 14, 1 Kings. And Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, slept with his fathers. This means he died and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. And Rehoboam's mother's name was Naamah, and Ammonitess. And Ammonitess, remember 1 Kings 11? Remember 1 Kings 11? And King Solomon loved many strange women together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of Moab, Ammonites. One of the strange women's son was Rehoboam, the son of Solomon. Who are the Ammonites? Who are the Ammonites?
They're the descendants of Lot.
Yeah, Ammon Jordan. Yeah, by the first daughter, he had the land of Ammon. These were the enemies of God. The land of the Philistines were the enemies, and God sandwiched Israel between these two. And these were the great headaches of God, of God's people. Of course, the land of Moab is called, that's southern Jordan. Moab was the second son of Lot by incestuous relationship with his daughters. When they were delivered from Sodom and just south of the Dead Sea, they went into a cave, and they didn't seduce their father for the sake of sex. They seduced their father because it was the greatest disgrace since his wife had died, been turned to a pillar of salt. And, of course, we know that's the Salt Sea, and Sodom is just south of the Salt Sea or the Dead Sea. And I don't know if it was an eruption of salt that came down, and fire from God was some volcanic eruption. There very well could be. But to turn someone into a pillar of salt was an old ancient term meant to kill someone. So it doesn't mean that she went like you see in a movie, you know, and she freezes, you know. It could have been God erupted that and threw it down upon her. And when she looked back, it doesn't mean that just she went, oh, gosh, I wish I was back there. Probably she probably turned back and stayed while they were walking off. And if there was some kind of eruption, it came down upon her. That there was, these salt dunes are all around here, and Sodom was just south of the Salt Sea. When they came out of Sodom, his daughters took him into a cave, seduced him so their seed wouldn't die. So this Lot is the nephew. This is the land. The land of Jordan is the land of Lot. What was it Lot said he wanted when Abraham said, we've got all this problem between me and your kinsmen. What was it Lot said? He said, give me the well-watered plains of Jordan. That's what he wanted. This is the land of Lot. You remember King Hussein, not Saddam Hussein. King Hussein, the little bald-headed guy, and he was this real quiet and real gentle. He was scared to death all the time because it's okay to be over here in Iraq screaming and cussing and yelling at Israel. But it's real, real, very dangerous to be next door to Israel since this is a world power, nuclear power. And listening to your brother cuss him, he had to be real careful and real gentle and walk very softly. And before he died, he was always just kind of a buffer state, kind of like taking the flak from both sides. He was like, he didn't get too upset at Israel because he's right next door. Well, this is the descendants of, that's the descendants of Lot is what it is. Ammon, the first son of Lot was Ben-Ami. Get the word Ammon or the Ammonites. Ammon, Jordan, is the capital city. The land of Moab, you remember, Ruth was a Moabite. She came back with Naomi to Jerusalem. So, where were we? All right, now, let's get back to these. Now, we're going to this next king here, Ahijah, or Abijam. If you'll notice, it's still the same person. I've got my page like this, and turn your page over there. Look at chapter 15 of 1 Kings, but also look at chapter 13 of 2 Chronicles, because we're going to see the same man here. We're going to read about him. And what we're doing, as we're going through Israel, remember this morning's message. What we're doing, as we're going through these kings from 1 Samuel, the whole purpose of this to 2 Chronicles, God says, if you're obedient to me, he said, I'll cause you to beat all your enemies. You'll stay in the land. Everything will be prosperous. But the thing that I will finally do, if you go after other gods, I'm going to scatter you. I'll send the sword, the famine, the pestilence, and my last judgment would be the beast. That'll be Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome, and I will scatter you all over the face of the earth. Well, of course, as we watch these kings go from one, they're either going after gods or they're going after their own ambition, which is the god of self, isn't it? They're killing one another right and left, slaughtering and murdering. When you get into the Old Testament, there's not anything you're going to see on TV or anywhere else that's going to be as graphic as the things that we'll read in the Old Testament. It's when people start realizing how interesting it is, especially the ones that watch the soap operas, they say, honey, I think I'll start reading the Old Testament. Now, look here in 2 Chronicles 13 and 1. Now, in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, he's still king, began Ahijah to reign over Judah. That's because, and he's called Ahijah, A-B-I-J-A-H, but don't don't confuse him with Ahijah the prophet, and don't confuse him with Abijah the son of Jeroboam. Abijah was also a king, so the son of Rehoboam. It's on the chart over here. The next king in the Davidic line, in the lineage of Judah, Abijah. Rehoboam's made a mess of things. Solomon's made a mess of things. David repented after murdering an adulterer. He's a man after God's own heart. Saul makes a mess of things. Abijah makes a little bit of mess of things. Let's read about Abijah. And we're going to watch as these kings, one after the other, they either turn after their own ambition, after power and money and greed. They go after women. They go after the kingdom, and they want what they want. They covet power, money, stuff. Sounds like a bunch of real estate agents, doesn't it? Sounds like a bunch of musicians, a bunch of insurance salesmen. I like to say salesman. It's like a curse word, isn't it? Salesman. He's a salesman. Yeah. Does that sound good? Okay, now. All right, now look at chapter 15, verse 1. Now in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, that's what it said over here, in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, in 13 and 1 of 2 Chronicles, it says, in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, the son of Nebat reigned Abijam. He's called Abijam here. He's called Abijah. Notice the difference in the spelling. In the 13th chapter, 1st verse, 2nd Chronicles, it's A-B-I-J-A-H. It's A-B-I-J-A-M. Same person in 1st Kings. Same person. Spelling, a little different. Now, in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, reigned Abijam over Judah. Now, that's very important to pay attention. Abijah's Judah. This is southern Judah. These are legitimate kings. Genesis, the 49th chapter, when Jacob gathers his sons around him, and it says it came time that Israel must die. Israel, or Jacob, had to die, and he calls his 12 sons around him, and he says, and he blesses them all, and he gets to Judah, his fourth born son, and they're listed in the order that they're born, and he says, when he gets to Judah, he says, the scepter will never depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come. And never does the scepter depart from Judah. One person in here tries to upset the throne and tries to steal the throne of Judah. Who's that?
That lady.
That lady. Athaliah. We'll go through her story. This is a witch, a 100% bona fide witch.
So what she is. No is.
She is no lady. That's no lady. That's Athaliah. Yeah. Yeah. She has all of her sons, all of her grandsons killed. That's Ahaziah's children. Her husband is Jeroboam. Her mother is Jezebel. No wonder she's this way. I mean, isn't it amazing that you never hear the stories of Athaliah and Joab? They needed to be married, didn't they? They could have killed the world. If they had been married to each other, wouldn't it? Well, especially if they had lived in a palace with.
They killed one another.
Yeah, they probably would have. They'd had the biggest fights. They'd had machine guns over on each side of the room, fired one another. Okay, now, Abijah begins to reign over Judah, and Jeroboam is still alive, isn't he? So northern Israel doesn't change kings yet, and you watch the kings change. These are illegitimate kings up here. These are whoever. This up here is the survival is the strongest, the fittest up here. Whoever can kill who in northern Israel gets to stay. That's just what that's about up here. Down here, Judah. Because this is the king. But they have an edge that they don't have down here. Why? You know why there was so much enmity between the two? Well, they had the ownership. They had the king. And each one of them said, I got the king. Well, yeah, we're owners. Isn't that something? And God put them at each other's throats. And we find at the end of time that the two no longer have an enmity against each other there in the 11th chapter of Isaiah and the 37th chapter of Ezekiel. Take one stick for Judah, one stick for Joseph, put them together, and they'll be one at the end of time. Well, they're one now. Let's read on. 3 years reigned he in Jerusalem, And his mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. And Abishalom had to be an Ammonite, wasn't he? Yeah. When I get studying these things, I'll go in and start looking up all the names of these people and who they're from and where they're from. And Maacah was the Ammonite queen. And he walked in all the sins of his father. What does that mean? Like father, like son. That's right. His father was who? Rehoboam. And Rehoboam followed the sins of his father. And who is his father?
Solomon.
And they walked after all these evil things. And his heart was not perfect with the Lord. When you read these words, this means this is an evil king. He's not a prominent evil king. He's just kind of a so-so evil king. His heart was not perfect with the Lord God as the heart of David, his father. Now, let me show you something. You have to understand this. When they said father, they didn't mean the immediate ancestor. They didn't mean the immediate progenitor of the family. His heart was not perfect toward the Lord as David, his father. Well, David was actually his great-grandfather, wasn't he? So when you're talking about his grandfather was Solomon, David was his great-grandfather, so they would call a man a father. And you're going to find this, you have to really pay attention to this, because sometimes as you're going through scriptures, you'll say, I didn't think that was their father. I didn't think this is her mother. They meant in the ancestral line. So keep that in mind. Now let's read on. Nevertheless, for David's sake, did the Lord his God give him a lamp in Jerusalem. There will be a light in Jerusalem, and that is implying the temple in Jerusalem. And God's going to keep a light there for David, and the light is going to come from Jerusalem because that's where the temple is. And the only official light in Jerusalem was the candlesticks, wasn't it? But David is called a lamp in Jerusalem. And for the sake of David, he's going to keep a king in Jerusalem because the scepter will not depart from Judah, to set up his son after him and to establish Jerusalem. He's going to keep a son in the lineage. Because David did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord and turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save only the matter of Uriah the Hittite. And there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam all the days of his life. Now the rest of the acts of Abijah and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And there was war between Abijah and Jeroboam. And Abijah slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the city of David. And Asa, his son, reigned in his stead. Now we're getting to a good man. I like Asa. Abijah did not live after the ways of David, his father. But Asa, how in the world can Abijah come up and have a son like Asa? I don't know. How can Hezekiah have a son like Manasseh? I don't know. Whew. Look at our fathers. How can we live the way we live, man? Look here. If you'll notice, Abijah has 8 verses dedicated to him here, doesn't he? Not a real important king. Look over here in a second. Well, look over here in 2 Chronicles. Let's look and see him over here. 2 Chronicles. Let's look at his life here in 13th chapter, because you're going to get a few things different here to show you the little bit of difference. Verse 1, chapter 13, 2 Chronicles. In the 18th year of King Jeroboam began Abijah to reign over Judah. And he reigned 3 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Micaiah. The daughter, and her name is spelled different. It's spelled Maacah over in the other. Remember? Maacah. His mother's name was Micaiah. Maacah in chapter 2 of 15 of 1 Kings. The daughter of Uriel of Gibeon, there was war between Abijah and Jeroboam. And Abijah set the battle in array with an army of valiant men of war, even 400,000 chosen men. Quite an army, isn't it? Jeroboam also set the battle in array against him with 800,000 chosen men, being mighty men of valor. What is this going on? This is brother fighting brother, isn't it? It's not unlike the Civil War, is it? This is the North and the South. Here's the gray, here's the blue. It's the North fighting South. over power structure. That's all it's about. They didn't get along with each other, much less with the pagans. And Abijah stood up among Mount Zemaraim, which is Mount Ephraim, and said, note that, Zemaraim, Mount Horeb is the same, H-O-R-E-B is the same as Sinai. Always note that. Ought you not to know that the Lord God of Israel gave the kingdom over Israel to David forever, even to him and to his sons by covenant of salt? Every one of the sacrifices had to be offered with salt. And we're the salt of the earth, aren't we? And the salt was used. They used salt to destroy all the decaying matter. They would pile tons of salt on the bodies, the dead bodies in the Valley of Hinnom. Where did they get all that salt? Where would they get all that salt? Just a few miles away, they got trillions of tons around the Dead Sea. All these salt dunes everywhere. And they would put salt. Isn't it amazing? God gave them a natural septic system here just a few miles away. They'd haul it off over there. They'd pile salt on it. It would kill the stink. It would kill the stink of dung. Well, Paul said, all of my accomplishments in the third chapter of Philippians are but dung, skubalon. It's K-U-B-A-L-O-N. And he said, everything, all the things that I've accomplished, he said, I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews. He said, I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. He said, I'm circumcised the eighth day of Israel. I'm not a proselyte. I've got all these accomplishments. I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisee. My father's a Pharisee, and that's dung. Let's pour salt on it. Kill it. They actually put salt around their, not on their crops, but put it around the crops. The salt would kill the crop. But they put it around the roots, and it would kill all the dead tissue and make everything come forward. It was used as a type of fertilizer. So let's read on. Verse 5. Ought you not to know that the Lord God of Israel gave the kingdom over to David forever, and even to him and his sons by covenant of salt? Yet Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, servant of Solomon, son of David, is risen up and hath rebelled against his Lord. Of course, Jeroboam is defending this in Bethel, this altar that he raised up and established golden calf worship. And he told the people, lest you go back and serve Rehoboam, behold the gods that brought you out of Egypt, the golden calves. And there are gathered unto him vain men, the children of Baal. There were no Levites. You remember we studied under Jeroboam, no priesthood in northern Israel. Remember that? No priests, no Levites. They all got out of there. They were worshiping idols in northern Israel. And God said, I will cut off all the seed of Jeroboam, all him that pisseth against the wall. I'll kill all the male sons in Israel. He said, there will be no more seed of Jeroboam. God's going to destroy Jeroboam, and he's going to do it. He's going to do it by this man, Baasha. Nadab, Jeroboam's son, is going to start reigning, and Baasha is this wild man that comes up. And this man is so evil and so godless, he starts murdering all of Jeroboam's sons. He says, I'll get rid of them. Say, you know what we're talking about? We're talking about Israel, the children of God. These evil men. But there were three kings that were righteous, wasn't they? Somebody tell me who they were. Josiah, Hezekiah, and David. And Asa gets real close, and Jehoshaphat gets real close, and Jehu gets real close. So these are upside Hezekiah and David and Josiah. I really loved Asa. I really loved Jehu and Jehoshaphat. And I just think, why couldn't they just held on and not pulled away and done the things they did? Jehoshaphat was a really good guy. He just liked to hang around Ahab. That's something, isn't it? But you know what? He's not unlike me, because I used to hang around a guy, an old gospel singer, and that guy'd get me in more trouble than I could get out of. He nearly got me put in jail and prison and everything else. Jehoshaphat got to hanging around Ahab, and his son Jehoram saw Ahab and Jezebel's daughter Athaliah and said, I think I kind of like her. She looks good. He went out and found the devil with a blue dress on. That's what he found. Whew. See, when you're running around with the wrong people, what do you get into? Jehoshaphat got himself into hot water he couldn't get out of. His son brings hell down into southern Judah. Just literal living hell comes down. Yet Jeroboam, verse 6, yet Jeroboam the son of Nebat, the servant of Solomon, the son of David, is risen up and hath rebelled against his Lord, and there are gathered unto him vain men, the children of Belial, and have strengthened themselves. Belial, that's just another term for Satan. Children of the devil, and have strengthened themselves against Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, when Rehoboam was young and tender-hearted and could not withstand them. You've got Jeroboam has got this huge army, and he's got 800,000, and Rehoboam's got 400,000. And this is brothers fighting over the land. What their desire is power. It's not unlike when you go out here into the real estate, insurance, political world. It's men fighting over power and money and position. That's all it is. It is no different going on here.
In Europe, I mean, for hundreds of years, wasn't everybody related?
Yeah.
And they kill each other and just do it.
This is family killing family is what it is. That's all it is. These are the children of God. This is what we think of Israel. We don't think of something this corrupt, do we? Look here. And against Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, Rehoboam was young and tenderhearted and could not withstand him. Verse 8, now you think to withstand the kingdom of the Lord in the hand of the sons of David, and you be a great multitude, and there are with you golden calves, which Rehoboam made you for gods. Now, Jeroboam made you for gods. Have you not cast out the priest of the Lord? There were no Levites in northern Israel. This is an indictment against Jeroboam, the sons of Aaron, and the Levites. None are in northern Israel. And you've made priests after the manner of the nations of the land. And Jeroboam invented this, and it was an imagination of his own heart. Not unlike these preachers that have imagined that they're priests of God in these churches. People say, you get angry. You mean this is too angry to get because these guys are polluting the Word of God and the temple of God? And the preachers that call themselves preachers, they don't care about God's Word and truth. We think these guys are off the wall. So are the Baptists in America and the Church of Christ and the Pentecostals and the Charismatics. They're not unlike them, are they? And have made you priest after the manner of the nations of the other lands. Look over. Let's just go back and hold your place there and go right back over here. Let's see, where did Jeroboam do that? Go back to 1 Kings. He did it right here. Look here in 1 Kings, the 12th chapter. Jeroboam, after he made these golden calves, in verse 28, behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt, the golden calves. Verse 31, he made an house of high places and made priests of the lowest of the people, which were not of the sons of Levi. And Jeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month, in the 15th day of the month, that didn't have anything to do with anything. Like unto the feast that is in Judah, and he offered upon the altar, so did he in Bethel, sacrificing unto the calves that he had made. And he placed in Bethel the priests of the high places which he made, so he offered upon the altar which he had made in Bethel, 15th day of the eighth month, even in the month which he had devised of his own heart. He made it up. When people go after other gods, what's the first thing they do? Now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do in the 11th chapter of Genesis. They imagine, he devised, he just made it up. I'll make me up a god, and I'll call it righteous. And I'll call it Jehovah. He said, behold, Jehovah is these two calves that brought you out of Egypt. And he only did it because he was afraid of losing the northern kingdom, and he was afraid of the people going back down here and serving Rehoboam, because Rehoboam had got the message from Shemaiah, don't you attack Jeroboam, this is of me. God said, this is my dealing. He said, don't you attack. And Jeroboam says, I'll invent calves to keep them from going back south. Now, verse 9, chapter 13, 2 Chronicles. Have you not cast out the priests of the Lord, the sons of Aaron, the Levites, and have made you priests after the manner of the nations of other lands, so that whosoever cometh to consecrate himself with a young bullock and seven rams, the same may be a priest of them that are no gods? These are not gods. They're dead gods, Jeremiah said. They have no breath. They're tree gods. They're calf gods. They're sun gods. They're not gods. But as for us, the Lord is our God. This is southern Judah. And we have not forsaken him, and the priests which minister unto the Lord are the sons of Aaron, and the Levites wait upon their business. You remember in the old scriptures, back when they were coming out of Egypt, and when one priest would do the wrong thing, when Korah tried to offer up incense to God, God killed him along with his 285 followers. Plus nearly 15,000 people of the children of Israel who murmured against God for killing Korah there in the 16th chapter of Numbers. He killed Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, for offering strange fire. And then he said, don't you mourn for them. I'll kill you too, Aaron, and your sons. You think God's not serious about what he requires, and yet they don't even have any priests of God in northern Israel. Under Jeroboam, he runs all the priests out, because if they got priests, somebody would preach and somebody would get convicted. So he said, get rid of the priests and we'll invent our own. Verse 11, they burn unto the Lord every morning, every evening, talking about the priests of God. Burnt sacrifices and sweet incense, the showbread, also set they in order upon the pure table, and the candlesticks of gold with the lamps thereof to burn every evening, for we keep the charge of the Lord our God. But you have forsaken him, northern Israel, and gone after Jeroboam's gods. And behold, God himself is with us. He's our captain. He's our king. We're still listening to him. Reminds me, you know what this reminds me of there in 2 Kings, the 17th, 18th chapter, where that the Assyrian king had come down to destroy northern Israel. God had called him in to carry northern Israel into captivity. And the Assyrian king said, well, as long as we're here, let's go on down to southern Judah and destroy them. Only problem is southern Judah hadn't become polluted yet with all that godless idol worship. And when the Assyrian king came down, he came up against the wall of Jerusalem. He had a messenger. He called his Rabshakeh, and he sent his Rabshakeh to the wall of Jerusalem. He said, you go tell your king Hezekiah, we've come down to destroy him too, since we've taken northern Israel. This is one man you don't talk to about destroying anything.
That's
2 Kings 17 and 18. He said, you go tell Hezekiah. And Hezekiah was worried to death because this huge army set outside the city of Jerusalem. And Sennacherib said, the great king has come to destroy Judah. No king has stood before me. We just took your brother, northern Israel, into captivity. You won't stand either. And God said, not yet. You're not going to do this because they haven't turned away from me yet. And Hezekiah got real nervous and went to Isaiah and said, what shall we do? Isaiah went and prayed to the Lord, just about 60-word prayer. Isaiah said, you can go to sleep tonight, Hezekiah. God's going to take you. And everybody went home and went to bed. God sent the death angel down to the camp of Sennacherib. He killed 185,000 men one night. You're not going to take Israel, southern Judah yet, because they're still righteous when Hezekiah is here. When you look back, and that's what I'm thinking of when I'm reading this right here. Behold, they're saying, which verse was I in there? Verse 12, 2 Chronicles 13 and 12, and behold, God himself is with us for our captain. We've got a captain that'll destroy when we're serving Jehovah God. And his priests was sounding trumpets to cry alarm against you, O children of Israel. Fight ye not against the Lord God of your fathers, for ye shall not prosper. But Jeroboam caused an ambushment to come about behind them. So they were before Judah, and the ambushment was behind them. And when Judah looked back, behold, the battle was before and behind. And they cried unto the Lord, and the priests sounded with the trumpets. And the men of Judah gave a shout, and as the men of Judah shouted, it came to pass that God smote Jeroboam and all Israel, all of Israel. Now, what does that mean, all Israel? Huh?
Is that the northern kingdom?
That's northern kingdom. Anytime it says Israel after the split, it's talking about northern Israel. He smote, Jeroboam was the king of northern Israel, and he smote. You see, they had the righteousness of God in southern Judah. They still had the Levites and the priest of Aaron, the sons of Aaron. And before Abijah and Judah, God smote them before Abijah, the king of southern Judah. Even though he wasn't living righteously, they still had the priests of God offering sacrifice in southern Judah. And the children of Israel fled before Judah. And God delivered them into their hands, and Abijah and his people slew them with a great slaughter. So there fell down slain of Israel 500,000 chosen men. How many did they have to start with? They had 800,000. You remember up here previous in the chapter? They had 800,000. 500,000 were killed. That means they only had 300,000 left. How many did southern Judah start with? 400,000. 400,000 men killed 500,000 because they shouted to the Lord and said, God save us. Who is Jeroboam going to cry to? The golden calf gods? Save us, golden calves? Thus the children of Israel were brought under at the time, and the children of Judah prevailed because they relied upon the Lord God of their fathers. We keep saying this. It doesn't have to do with numbers. Has to do with trusting God. And let me tell you something. This applies in our life. I said this last Wednesday night. If we can learn that God's got this great arrangement of our lives, predestination is true. He's declared the end from the beginning. And when we all of our enemies are flying up against us, we need to cry out with David, God, plead my cause. Fight my battle is what that means. But God won't let... What is the only way he's going to let you win against your enemy? How's the only way he's going to let you win? Huh? That's it. Obedient. If we obey God, didn't he say you go out against your enemy one way, they'll flee seven ways? See, it had nothing to do with 400 against 800,000 here. Nothing to do with it. David went into battle against a giant. Jonathan and his armor bearer took on the whole entire Philistine army. Gideon took 300 men and took on 127,000 Midianites. And with his 300 men, he had no weapons. He had some pitchers and some lamps and trumpets. That's it. Stood on top of a mountain and blew the trumpets, broke those lamps, flashed and cried, the sword of the Lord and Gideon. And they turned their swords on each other. God says, all I need is an obedient man. I'll fight the battle. That's true in our lives today. I've begun to trust God these last 16, 17 years. For the first 25, 30 years of my ministry, I didn't. I started preaching this predestination message, and I thought, God, it'll all kill me when I start this. I didn't realize that God actually had this written on the hearts of the believers out there, and they'd come, oh, I hear this. I hear this truth. Where is that coming from? That's what they do. And that's what's going on here. 400, we see another great battle in the following chapter when Asa goes up against this insurmountable army of Ethiopians. But if you'll notice, they've got the priests of God here. Jeroboam had a bunch of priests of golden calves. And Abijah pursued after Jeroboam, verse 19, and took the cities from him. Bethel with the towns thereof. Now, what was in Bethel? Huh? That was the altar where Jeroboam set up golden calf. And who was it that cried against that altar? Iddo. He was the great prophet of God, and he prophesied Josiah 337 years before he ascended the throne of Israel. And they took Bethel. Bethel means house of the Lord. That's where that's where in the 28th chapter of Genesis, Jacob sees the angels coming down, up and down the ladder, and he says, I'll call this name Bethel, house of the Lord. But they took the house of the Lord and set up golden calves in it. And here, this is very important, because Abijah takes back this very system that's polluted with golden calf worship. With the towns thereof, and Jeshanah, with the towns thereof, and Ephraim, with the towns thereof, neither did Jeroboam recover strength again in the days of Abijah. And the Lord struck Jeroboam, and he died. How's that? Ain't that something?
Well, I didn't think God made people sick.
Yeah. They said God won't make you sick. He'll kill you. I kill, I make alive, he said in Deuteronomy 32:39. You know what amazes me? God doesn't have this great big finale. Like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da- about to get the good guy. No, God says, bang, you're dead. Now let's get on with the show. I mean, we make movies and it's just like, we got to build it up to a big crescendo. God don't do that. He says, and God killed Jeroboam and died. Now let's go to another king. He doesn't make a big production out of it, does he? Neither did Jeroboam recover his strength in the days of Abijah. And the Lord struck Abijah and he died. But Abijah waxed mighty and married 14 wives and begat 20 and 2 sons and 16 daughters.
Yeah, who did he kill? You just said he struck Abijah.
Huh?
He struck Jeroboam.
Neither did Jeroboam recover his strength again in the days of Abijah, and the Lord struck him, and he died. He struck Jeroboam, and he died. And Abijah waxed mighty. He marries and has all these kids, and the rest of the acts of Abijah and his ways, I like that. And his ways and his sayings are written in the story of the prophet Iddo. Iddo is the one who prophesied against the altar, wasn't he? Now, we're moving into another king.
Well, Jim, let me ask you this right here. Is this what the guys, like I'd seen something on TV over the last few days about all of these books that are mentioned in the collected work that we have here?
Mm-hmm.
Well,
there's a lot of things. Yeah, a lot of these guys wrote books that are not in the canon of Scripture. There's many books written that's not in the canon of Scripture. But we're not going to insert them right now. We can talk about them. They're in this.
They're like an audiopharpha, but
yeah.
These works have been lost to us.
Well, we don't know exactly where they are. If you take your McClintock and Strong, look at 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, look at 1 and 2 Kings. They seesaw back and forth as to who actually wrote all these books. We know that Samuel did not write 1 Samuel. He couldn't have written 1 Samuel. He died in the 25th chapter. He couldn't have written the 26th chapter, could he? 27th, 28th, 29th. He couldn't have written the chapter about the witch of Endor because he was dead for 2 years. Could he? No, he couldn't have written that. But that takes a lot of study. We won't get anywhere studying that here. Now we enter new king. Enter one of my favorite guys. Just as far as the kings of Israel, I really love Asa. He's just such a good guy. I mean, he messes up. But we'll see him in heaven. Now, look here. We've seen a hellish man, Saul. David loves God, commits adultery, murder God, forgives him, man after God's own. Solomon going after all his wives, gods, sun gods, and moon goddesses. And then Jeroboam, he's dead now. We got Jeroboam dead. We're going to get into his son. Little to no time is given to Nadab. Now, Nadab is a common name. Nadab was also a name of one of Aaron's sons. But don't confuse him, because that was many, many, many years before this. Now, you've got Abijah. Rehoboam's dead. We got Abijah dead. We're going into Asa. Asa, king of Israel. Let's go back over here to 1 Kings. 1 Kings doesn't have as much to say about Asa as 2 Chronicles. But let's go back to 1 Kings. Let's look at Asa here. Now, How much? I'm about to run out of time. I'm just getting Asa. Well, let's read a little bit about Asa. Verse 9. Where did we read down to here? Yeah, we got through verse 8. Abijah. If you notice, we got more about Abijah in 2 Chronicles, the 13th chapter, because we got him attacking northern Israel. We've got him overcoming Jeroboam becoming weak, and God killing Jeroboam in the 13th chapter of 2 Chronicles in relationship to Abijah. But we don't have all of that in the 15th chapter of 1 Kings. In the 15th chapter of 1 Kings, we get down to chapter, he's only got 8 verses dedicated to him, Abijah the son of Rehoboam. 8 verses in 1 Kings, the 15th chapter. In verse 9, the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah. And 41 years reigned he in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. And Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father. Remember Abijah his father? The Bible says that in verse 3 of the same chapter that Abijah walked in all the sins of his father which he had done before him, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord. But Asa's heart is perfect with the Lord. He did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father. And he took away the Sodomites out of the land and removed all the idols that his fathers had made. And I love verse 13. When the Bible says, honor thy father and thy mother, he honored his mother. He honored his mother, Maacah. He said, Mom, you don't know anything about God, and you and your goddess is going out. You're off the throne. You're not queen over Israel anymore. You've been queen mother, but you're not now. You're out. And Maacah, his mother, even her he removed from being queen because she had made an idol in a grove. And Asa destroyed her idol and burned it by the brook Kidron. He said, I'm going to place a value. The word honor in the Greek is the word time, T-I-M-E. It means to value. The best thing he could tell his mother is get Christmas out of your house. Get that tree goddess out. And God pronounces him righteous here, doesn't he? He says he walks in the way of his father, David. He does the righteousness of God, and he honors his mother and says, you can't be queen in Israel because you're going after another idol god. Tell your mother the truth about the Lord. I've told mine. You can't have your idol around me, mother, the idol of self. I like that. But the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days. And he brought in the things which his father had dedicated and the things which himself had dedicated unto the house of the Lord, silver and golden vessels. And there was war between Asa and Baasha, king of Israel, all their days. Asa and Baasha have got one of the great rivalries in the Old Testament. Baasha was evil to the core. This man was one ungodly man. In fact, look over here. Jeroboam dies. Look here. We'll look at Jeroboam's death here. Look at verse 25. And Nadab, the son of Jeroboam, began to reign over Israel in the second year of Asa, king of Judah, reigned over Israel 2 years. Nadab, the son of Jeroboam, starts to reign. Here's the son of Jeroboam. Now, remember here last week, we read these words over here in chapter 14, verse 10. Therefore, behold, I will bring evil upon the house of Jeroboam and will cut off from Jeroboam him that pisseth against the wall. You say, that sounds like crude words, Jim. Let me tell you, God gets crude. If you think when God says, I'll make you drink your own piss and eat your own dung, he said, you have no pity for me. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll make you eat your kids. And they ate their own dung. You say, I won't ever get that hungry. You won't. Have you ever been hungry for a month without anything to eat? When that plane crashed down in the Andes Mountains in South America, I read the book Alive back when it was first published before they made the movie. It's unbelievable. Those people, they wait till the bodies froze. They were starving up on this mountaintop in the snow, freezing. They'd take strips. They'd wait till the body froze real solid. Then they'd take strips off of the people and they'd eat them. You say, I wouldn't eat that. God said, I'll make, this is what I'll do to you. You say, this is crude language. No, what God is doing when he says this, I'll cut off all the males of Jeroboam. And the ones that piss against the walls are the ones that have babies. I will kill all of these sons of Jeroboam, and there won't be any children of Jeroboam. That's what he's saying. You know what they call this? What did they call this? When a man's name was stricken.
Stricken from the book of life.
It was cut out of the book of life. Not the Lamb's book of life. The book of life was those little courthouses where they kept the names of their descendants, and the Jews were so proud of their ancestry, and Paul speaks of vain genealogies. He said, no, don't go after that. He said, I'll tell you what I'll do to you when you go after another god. I'll kill all your sons.
Stops the seed.
Yes, sir, he stops the seed. That's what he's doing. That was the greatest disgrace to the Israelites, because every one of them, especially in the tribe of Judah, they wanted to be the woman that would have the seed of the Messiah coming through their veins. That was prophesied through the Old Testament. And he said, and I'll take away the remnant of the house of Jeroboam as a man taketh away dung till it be all gone. Let me tell you, God don't play around. When he says he'll make the dogs lick the blood of Ahab, he did exactly that. When he says he made the dogs eat the body of Jezebel, he did exactly that. You say, God says some hard words. Man can't get more crude than God will get with us, what he'll do to us. Look here. Let's see it happen here under Nadab. In verse 25, Nadab, the son of Jeroboam, began to reign over. This is verse 25, chapter 15. Nadab, the son of Jeroboam, began to reign over Israel in the second year of Asa, king of Judah, and reigned over Israel 2 years. Nadab is reigning while Asa's reigning in southern Judah. Nadab's reigning here, Asa's reigning here. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord and walked in the way of his father and in his sin, wherewith he made Israel to sin. Nadab gets 2 verses in 1 Kings. And then he's out of the picture. He don't live. God don't let the sons of Jeroboam get any glory, not even in print. And Baasha, the son of Ahijah, of the house of Issachar. This is not an Ahijah in Israel. He's of the house of Issachar, a completely different tribe. Conspired against him, and Baasha smote Nadab at Gibbethon, which belonged to the Philistines. For Nadab and all of Israel lay siege to Gibbethon. Even in the 3rd year of Asa, king of Judah, did Baasha slay him, and reigned in his stead. And it came to pass when he reigned that he smote all the house of Jeroboam. He didn't just kill Nadab. He killed all of his brothers. He left not to Jeroboam any that breathed of any of the males. Just what God said he'd do. Why? Golden calf worship? You can't sin and get by. You can't serve the idol god of self and get by. You can serve God a while and you can leave. You can't get away from God. He knows where you are. You may be in a nightclub in Spokane, Washington. He knows where you are, Jim Brown. You can't get away from him. You can go hide in a cave. Nobody else knows where you are, but you're not missing to God. According unto the saying of the Lord, which he spake by his servant Ahijah, Jeroboam's prophet. He's going to destroy you, Jeroboam, the Shilonite. Oh, man. Now, Asa and Baasha are at odds. I don't know where to go. I got so many places to go. All right. Let's go back here. Let's go back to verse 17. Let's read down to verse 25. Well, 16, verse chapter 15, 1 Kings. And there was war between Asa and Baasha, king of Israel, all their days. And Baasha, king of Israel, went up against Judah and built Ramah that he might not suffer any to go out or come in to Asa, king of Judah. He's building a Berlin Wall. You can't go out of here. You're locked into northern Israel. Don't go to Judah. You can't go. He's got a wall there, and he says, you're not going through. Then Asa took all the silver and gold that were left in the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house and delivered them into the hand of his servants. And King Asa sent them to Ben-Hadad. Oops. 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 Here's the righteous man of God. We found him in the 14th chapter of 2 Chronicles. Here's the good man of God. He's fighting Baasha. He's up against not just a formidable enemy, devious, underhanded, low-down, lying, snake in the grass, Baasha. But what does he do? Now, in the 14th chapter of 2 Chronicles, Asa prays one of the greatest prayers that's ever been prayed. He says, God, it is nothing. He takes 500,000 men and goes up against an Ethiopian army of 1,000,000. And the Ethiopians had 300 chariots. You couldn't whip 300 chariots if you had no chariots with anybody. Those chariots would run over the people just going slaughter right and left. They were the tanks of their day. He goes up against 1,000,000 Ethiopians. And Asa prays the prayer in the 14th chapter of 2 Chronicles. He says, Lord, it is nothing with thee to help those that are many or those that have no power. He said, let not man prevail against thee. And they'll go against the Ethiopians, and they destroy them with a great slaughter. They're outnumbered 2-1, and that's not even counting the chariots. And now, here's Asa. He comes up against Baasha here in this 15th chapter. It's in the 16th chapter of 2 Chronicles. After he trusts God, he goes against Baasha in the 16th chapter. And the first thing he does in the 16th chapter of 2 Chronicles, he forgets the 14th chapter of 2 Chronicles where he trusts God to go against the Ethiopians. He goes and tries to hire one of the most evil kings in the Old Testament, Ben-Hadad. Ben-Hadad is a Syrian. You can't deal with the devil and not pay. Ben-Hadad is the one in the 20th chapter of 1 Kings that tells southern Judah, I want everything you've got, your women, everything. You submit to me, I want an unconditional surrender. Well, when he tells Judah that, Ahab is the king of southern Judah. God doesn't even have a righteous king. And God says, you made me mad now, Ben-Hadad. You're telling my kingdom, I'll deal with Ahab. And he sends a prophet to Ahab and he says, Ahab, you're going to go against the king, Ben-Hadad, of Syria. And they've got hundreds of thousands. And you've got 7,000 in Judah, and you're not even a righteous king, but he's made me mad. I want you to go against him. And of course, Judah goes and fights against him in the mountains. And Ben-Hadad, and they slaughter the Syrians in the mountains. And he says, well, your God is the God of the mountains. You remember we said that they had gods of the mountains and gods of the hills. They called them demons. They said, your God is the demon of the mountains. That's why you whipped us in the mountains. God said, now you've really made me mad. He said, I want you to go out there on the plain. He said, I want you to go out on the plain. And he said, I want you to go up against these Syrians. Now, this is who Asa's making a deal with. He said, I want you to go. He tells Ahab, I want you to go against the Syrians on the plain. You've got 7,000. They've got hundreds of thousands. And Ahab said, who's going to give that order? And the prophet says, you. So they go out on the plains, and the scripture says, Ben-Hadad's people covered the plains like grasshoppers. And Israel went out and encamped against them like two little flocks of kids. Here's a little flock of goats here, and here's a little flock over here. And Israel's going, look at all those people. Good night. Now, this is who Asa's making a deal with. This man starts off so good, and he goes and employs a hellish king. And, of course, when Ahab and the children of Israel, and God's not even doing it for Ahab's benefit. Ahab just means the devil. He's doing it for his name's sake, for Israel. And they go in and camp against him like two little flocks of kids. And they say, okay, charge! And Israel, with 7,000 fighting men, kills 100,000 Syrians that day, Ben-Hadad's people. And they chase them up to a place called Aphek, and a wall falls down and kills 27,000 of them there. And Ahab goes and makes a deal with this man, Ben-Hadad. Isn't it amazing, even as good a man as this is, there's not a prayer in the Bible that I love more than his prayer. I love his prayer. If I can pray, look at his prayer one more time. I love this prayer as much as any prayer that's in all of the Bible. I guess it's my favorite prayer other than the Lord's Prayer. When he says prayer after this manner. But in 2 Chronicles 14, there's peace in the land because Asa tears down all the idols in the land. And God brings peace. If you look at verse 5, he took away all the cities of Judah, the high places, the images. The kingdom was quiet before him. Verse 1, Abijah slept with his fathers, and Asa, his son, reigns. He takes away all the idols. God brings peace in the land. He takes a 500,000 army. In verse 8, Asa had an army of men that had bare targets and spears out of Judah, 300,000, and out of Benjamin that bare shields and drew bows, 240,000. He had 580,000 men. All these were mighty men of valor, and there came out against them Zerah, the Ethiopians, with a host of 1,000,000, a million, and 300 chariots, and came unto Marash. And Asa went against him. And Asa prays to the Lord in verse 11 and said unto the Lord his God and said, Lord, it is nothing with thee to help with many or with them that have no power. Help us, O Lord our God, for we rest on thee. In thy name we go against this multitude, O Lord. Thou art our God. Let not man prevail against thee. And they went out and slaughtered them. But when you get to the 16th chapter of 2 Chronicles, he goes up against Baasha. And he tries to get Ben-Hadad. He goes to an outer source. Doesn't to an outer source. He goes to one wicked, super wicked, evil man to fight Baasha. Now, Ben-Hadad probably wasn't any more evil than Baasha. But God had supplied Asa in the 14th chapter. Why does he turn to this heathen in the 16th chapter?
Kind of like David, remember?
Yeah, it's just very sad when you see these things. We'll come back to Asa next week. We're into Asa. We're down to Baasha. We're going to go through all these kings. We're going to watch one after the other fall to the power of money, pride, self, gods. Anytime they came up with gods, the only reason Jeroboam invented they were familiar with the golden calves of Egypt. The only reason he invented them and said, these are the gods that brought you out, he didn't want to lose the kingdom. It was his hunger for power is what it was. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the picture of these kings and all that they're doing so we might learn from them, might learn not to live the way they lived. But Lord, I'm afraid we're all like Asa. We start with a humble heart and we forget that you're able to help with those that are many or those that have no power. We forget that the older we get, and the more we think we're in charge, we seem to employ the world to fight our battles. God, help us to understand that we need to rely upon you. Bring us back like you did David. Lord, humble us under your hand. If you have to destroy everything in our lives, if you have to destroy our families like you did his, you said you would put a sword between us and our families. God, fight our battles for us. Overcome our lives and remove the idol of self, because that's the only way we're going to win in life. And Lord, we'll win your way, not our way. Forgive us of our sin. Fight our battles. In Jesus' name, amen.